right there, you can see how utterly absurd this is. Again, I wish somebody could just make a GIF out of this. Huh? No. Maybe? No. Huh? No. Maybe? No. Huh? No. Maybe? No. Hey, everybody. Welcome back. I'm Dr. Bob Cargill, Associate Professor of Classics and Biblical Studies at the University of Iowa. I should also point out that I obviously deal with a lot of archaeology, but that I also did my dissertation in 2008 at UCLA, working in virtual reality, and then spent some time working with the Center for Digital Humanities prior to coming to Iowa. The reason I point this out is that there aren't a few of us, right? There are more than one of us who have high-level training in biblical studies, but also in archaeology and experience doing that, and also teach language, understand Hebrew and Aramaic. I teach those here at the university, but also who understand the digital humanities and the technologies involved in doing many of the modern things that are required now to do, you know, very niche level archaeological research. And the reason I bring that up is we are going to once again revisit one of the claims made by this Mount Ebal inscription team. And I hope to do this using a digital tool, Adobe Photoshop. Many of you are familiar with this. But I want to do an exercise that I hope will visualize for you, the viewer, exactly what so many of us scholars who are trained in these fields have been saying. Now, you've heard me say in any number of videos, I've made three of them so far, about this balagan, look that word up, about this complete mess, this nonsense that is this so-called Mount Ebal inscription. In case you need reminding, we're talking about a 2-centimeter piece of lead that cannot be opened, that the men making this claim say has an inscription inside. And there's nothing there. This is a Rorschach test. But they're making this claim. Of course, they went to the public first, then they spent a year publication shopping, trying to find some place that will publish their claims. They finally did this in a journal, an online journal called Heritage Science. Dr. Stripling said in an interview with Sean McDowell, and now that we've got the gravitas behind there, something to the effect of, now that we've got this academic article, there will be some gravitas associated. You can see what they're trying to do. This is a PR campaign. It's a media campaign. But they're trying to do essentially what the Green Scholars Initiative did with those forged Dead Sea Scrolls at the Museum of the Bible. Basically, you've got all these Dead Sea Scrolls. They're forged. They were purchased on the black market. But now you got to give them some backstory, some credibility, some history. And so you got to launder them, essentially. You got to hand them out to friendly scholars at these confessional universities and get scholars to publish them and work on them to give them some credibility. The publication, the peer review publication, was key to this group to even be recognized, to even be taken seriously. And of course, credible scholars still don't take it seriously. And I'm going to show you why. Now, we've made all the cases. We've said there's nothing there. From a theological standpoint, from an archaeological standpoint, this is bad science. This is bad theology. It's just wrong, up, down, all over. But for those of you who aren't familiar with the digital side of this, I want to show you why I said in many previous videos that Dr. Gershon Galil is just making this stuff up. He's imagining it. It's a Rorschach test. I'm not the only scholar saying this, right? Many of my colleagues are calling this a Rorschach test. They're just openly saying these aren't letters. These are striations, stress fractures. These are shadows and contours in degrading lead. That's what this is. They're seeing things and they want to believe. And in my last video, I said, let's just grant them all of that. Even if we grant them everything, this was an ancient scribe. He was literate. He could write with a stylus in lead on a 2-centimeter piece of thing. And he could make these tiny little letters. If we grant them everything that they're claiming, you've still got this ridiculous, a drunken ant at a picnic, I think I called it, this ridiculous scribal path to get to this, to which they're going to make up another story. Well, it's a curse tablet, so it's magic. And so it's never intended to be. They have to continue to make up these stories in order to make any of this make any sense at all, even to make it feasible. And then Gershon Galil made a chart, right? Here's the epigraphic chart. But of course, the letters don't look like each other. They're all different. They certainly don't look like any, the shapes resemble some of the paleo letters that we have, some of these old Hebrew letters or the Phoenician letters, some of the proto-Sinaitic script. But Dr. Galil has to say, no, this is a different script, because he has to make it up. He has to make it fit what he sees. And of course, whatever scribe is doing this is changing the shape of the letters every time. You can look at his chart and you can see this letter, which is supposed to be the same as this letter, doesn't look the same. Well, it's because it's such a tiny thing. It's this micros. They just have to keep making up stories. So let's grant them all of it. We shouldn't, because it's bad science, it's bad methodology, but let's grant them everything. What I want to do in this video is demonstrate to those who tend to want to believe Dr. Stripling and Dr. Galil why we're so quick to dismiss this. And my point is that even if we grant everything that they say, I will demonstrate using just comparative technology, just using their own data. This is data that they published. This is Dr. Galil's own data, that they are not being honest, that they are not being accurate. I won't say that they're manipulating the data, but they are grossly misrepresenting the data so that it can fit a narrative that they want to tell. And I'm going to do that using Photoshop. So you're going to see me looking over here. I've got a screen here. I've got the teleprompter in the screen here, obviously. But you're going to see me looking over here as I work in Photoshop. So for those of you not familiar with Photoshop, you can do lots of wonderful things. But all we're going to do is transpose Dr. Galil's reproduction. This is his drawing from his publication, Inherited Science. We're going to transpose that at a 50% transparency on top of this wonderful image that Perborius, this is a Twitter user named Perborius, put together. And what this Twitter user, Perborius, did was they took a bunch of these scans and put them together, compress them. And this is what Dr. Galil and the publication team says that they've done in their publication. So what this Twitter user did is just followed their own methodology and took a bunch of the scans, and you can see the scans, the cross sections of the scans in the upper left-hand corner. And the reason we're doing this is that it gives them the maximum amount of lines to draw from. Dr. Galil is saying, I see lines. This is deliberate. These are deliberate scribal marks to write this inscription. So we're going to give them as many scans as we can and compress them together into one image so that we can give them the maximum benefit of the doubt. Again, this is all nonsense, but let's grant it all to them and let's give them the maximum number of contours and lines and striations that we possibly can, right? I'm taking a long time to set this up, but I need you to understand what we're doing here. And then we're going to compare that to what Dr. Galil represented as what he sees in this scanned image. That scanning team that's done this before, they made a great scan. Let's see how Dr. Galil represents this. So if you look here at the Photoshop, I'm just going to go up here and grab my lasso tool, my marquee tool, and I'm going to make a rectangular marquee around Dr. Galil's drawing. So here you can see it. And I'm going to do this on the layer that is Dr. Galil's drawing. So here's the layer over here. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to edit. You can't see this part, but I'm going to make a copy. This is Control C. This is good old Control C copy. And then what I'm going to do is Control V, paste. And you'll see that a second layer has popped up here, right? This is our layer popped up here, and we're going to call this transparency layer. There we go. So on top of Dr. Galil's drawing is an identical layer. I didn't change anything. I just made a carbon copy, cut, paste, identical layer, except we're going to take this transparency layer, double click on it, and we're going to set the opacity here to 50%. You see what I'm doing? Just dragging this down to 50%. There we go. Okay. So now the transparency layer is a clone, is a copy of what Dr. Galil drew as his representation, what he sees in the scan, the compressed scans on the left. You got it? Dr. Galil drawing on the right, the actual scans of what they claim are scribal marks, deliberate scribal marks on the left. Now what we can do is we can take this transparency layer, if we grab our move tool here, and we can just take this transparency layer. See this? See how it's a perfect copy? I didn't change anything. I'm not doing anything. I'm trying to remove all subjectivity from my actions. I just want to show you what Dr. Galil represented as what he sees on this scan. And we're just going to drag it and superimpose it over here. Here we go. Now, you'll say, well, maybe the most famous thing that we can drag this on is this figure on the kind of the left side that looks like a human. He calls it a hay, right? So we're gonna bring this figure right here. And you'll notice that another thing that Dr. Galil did not do, and we'll talk about this for a second, is Dr. Galil did not use guidelines. They didn't, you know, when you do an archaeological excavation, you set out a grid, 5-meter grid, you put the bulks, and then every time you find an object within the square, you measure from one bulk, you measure from the other bulk, you measure the depth, and now you've got a three-dimensional location in space that you can recreate. So when we go into virtual reality, we can actually locate everything that was discovered in space. We know, whether you're using VR or not, we know where everything was found in relation to the locus in which it was discovered. But you need to have those lines, those grid lines, in order to make that relative measurement. Dr. Galil doesn't offer any of those, and I think I know why, and I'll show you here. But I'm going to add some grid lines right through this guy's head. You see this little hay? We're going to put one through this big pock mark. Right? These pock marks become important here. We're going to put one down here where you see on the left this mark here, and then we'll pull some in from the side. We'll put one through the head of this hay here, right? This is what Dr. Galil considers to be a hay. We'll put one through the head of through the center of this pock mark here. We'll put one through the center of this pock mark here. Maybe we'll put one over here through the center of this pock mark. You see what I'm doing? I'm making things that we can align. And again, you can see all these lines over here on the left. We'll come over here and we'll put one through this pockmark over here. Maybe we'll bring one from the top here and we'll put one through where the legs separate. That's what we'll call it. We'll put it right here, the legs of this hay, right? This hay person here. We'll put that right there. And maybe we'll put one through this pockmark. You see this pockmark right here? We'll put that horizontally there. And I don't know, maybe we'll put one horizontally through this pockmark right here. You can see it here. All right, that's enough grid lines. Now we go back over to our, to Dr. Galil's transparent drawing, and we're going to try to superimpose it. And let's take this head of this letter here, and we'll just try to superimpose it perfectly. You can see what I'm doing. We're superimposing it perfectly on the letter. Okay? So you can see that it is pretty good outline on the outside. You can see that I've got in this region, I'm going to grab a pencil just so that you can see it here. Let me get my pencil tool. And so I can write it, and let me get a different color here. So you can see this region right here, I have perfectly aligned what he calls is this head of this, what he, you know, looks like a stick figure, right? And you can see the lines that he's drawn. So we'll align that. We've got it aligned pretty well on the outside. And now what we can do is we can simply come over to the transparency layer, and we can turn it off. We can turn it on, we can turn it off, and here's what we get to do. So I made no changes. I just took a copy of Dr. Galil's representation of what he sees in the scan, and I'm just superimposing it over the scan itself so that you can see the representation versus the scan, and we're just going to turn it on and turn it off. So here we go again. On, off, on, off. On, off, on, are you getting sick of this yet? Off. And you can very quickly see the massive problems with Dr. Galil's representations. Because even if we grant them every crack, every striation, every pockmark, every shadow, even if we grant them all of this in multiple layers and push them together, you can see that what he's drawing, especially over here in this region, right? I mean, what do we see? We see a line here. We see, okay, you could have a line like that, and you can do this. We clearly see this pockmark here. We see this pockmark here. We see this thing coming down here, right? There's something here. I mean, you could say that there's a line there. I mean, we grant them everything. We shouldn't. These clearly aren't scribal marks. You can, you know, there's this stuff up here, but here's a pockmark over here, right? And where I put this, the center of this grid, there's this thing down here, right? That looks the same as everything else. You've got this thing here, right? You've got all of these. But if we come back over and we turn this back on, you have to ask yourself, what on earth is he doing? I'm just going to sit here. Hopefully somebody will be kind enough. Let me get rid of all of these. Maybe somebody can make an animated GIF, of just this. On, off, on, off, to show how patently absurd Dr. Galil's imagined representation of his own scans this is. Dr. Galil says there's a mem over on the right-hand side of this thing. He says there's a tav underneath it. He says, and again, we'll get our pen out here, he says that there's this pockmark here, and this pockmark here, and this pockmark here. Now, I'm going to be very generous. There's a line here, right? That's a line. There's a line here. You can see the line. There's a line here. Here's this cross that he's going to claim as a thing. He's going to claim that there's a cross here, right? There. Well, here's a shadow here. We're giving him everything, right? We're going to do this line up here, right? This clearly connects to this, right? It clearly connects. And now look at the picture on the right, right? Let's turn the transparency back on. Where on earth is he getting the body of this? I'm sorry. He's got a leg coming down. I mean, I'm calling this a stick man. I know it's not the letter, but we're just pretending here anyway. So there's a pockmark down here. You can see it, right? There's a pockmark down here. You can see it. We'll color it in. But he has basically filled in the blank spot, the blankest spot on the tablet. He's saying that's a letter, not a line, not a crevice, not a shadow, just a blank spot. Oh, that's a letter too, because it has to be. He needs it to be. He's got another one. He's got another one down here. He's saying this and this and this, right? They're all different shapes. They're all different sizes. By the way, I want to point out something else that, and this was Proborius's original complaint, is that not only are all of these supposed letters different shapes and different sizes, which you would not expect from a scribe, right? A literate scribe writing. And of course, it has to be because this is all made up. He's seeing things. It's my son, Judah, 7 years old, lying in the grass, looking up in the sky and looking at clouds. Daddy, look, I see an elephant. Oh, where, son? Oh, yeah, see his trunk. Oh, yeah, good job. That's what Dr. Galil's doing. He's looking over here and he says he sees things and he's going to represent it. But then when he represents it, not only is he making things up, but he's not even accurately transposing what he sees. Because I want to show you this again. All I did was transpose his photo on top of his images, and I granted them everything, and then I outlined over here. You see it? You can see these little cracks, these little lines, and we're calling that this person. We're giving him that. But then when you turn the transparency back on, that's not where he drew it. It's off. He did not accurately represent where these cracks are. Look at these two letters that he's claiming are up here, right here. This one and this one here, right? He's got this one and this one. You see those two? If we turn off the transparency and then we just delete those two letters, there's nothing there. Look at this thing up here. Here's a pockmark. Let's color this pockmark. Here's a pockmark. Let's color it in. Can you possibly say there's anything else there? Look, we can call this a shadow, right? There, you can call this a shadow here. It's a shadow. It's really not. Does anybody want to say that this is it's a shadow? It's a big depression or something. We can mark it. But what I'm interested in is this area right here, right? Do you see it? This teardrop-shaped pockmark and maybe this little thing here. You with me? Now look when I turn on the transparency. No! God, I'm going to have an apoplexy. No! This is supposed to be a scientific, archaeological, academic representation of a scan. And I just transposed it over and it's not even close. Maybe use some grid marks to help yourself out, but it's because it doesn't work. He needs to get those other two little letters under it. And then he bumps this one out to the right. Then God knows what is going on up here. I mean, who knows? What is this? Really? There's a Tav in here? Really? That's what this is? That's what this is, a Tav? Let's turn it off. There's a mem? Really? There's a mem here? All right, let's see it. Let's outline it. All right, that's where he says this is. These are his drawings. I did nothing. All I did was superimpose one over the other. There's an Aleph up here, really? You see this? Do you see this Aleph? That's supposed to, oh, here's another one. I'm just drawing what he's drawing. You can see I'm just copying what he's got, right? Right? I just copied what he's got, right? We'll turn off the transparency. We'll turn it back on. Now we'll undo those lines. Keep looking right there where he says those olives are. And now we'll turn off the transparency. What in the name of all that is holy is he seeing? And that's my point. When I say, and when other credible scholars say, there's nothing there, that's what we mean. It's not there. And even the things he wants to be there aren't accurately represented. This whole thing, oh my God, it's bad. There's no, they're putting it, this is what it's like. I'm a debunker, right? I've been doing this since grad school. I go on television, I go on Ancient Aliens, and I debunk. I'm the debunker on that show. I go on History Channel, and I do my best to do public scholarship and to say, this is a good claim, this is a bad claim, and I do it professionally. That's why they keep inviting me back to do this on television. And on occasion, there are a very few number of people, they're not all scholars, but there are a few number of people who make ridiculous claims. And we have to get together and use the media like this to say, no, stop it. Stop it. This is stupid. You aren't going to see published academic refutations of this garbage because journals of any repute whatsoever don't publish unprovenanced artifacts. They just don't. I don't know what Heritage Science is doing publishing this unprovenanced artifact. It came out from a dump pile that's been sitting there for 40 years. And yet, there they are publishing it. Why? Why is Heritage Science publishing this unprovenanced piece of junk that is clearly misrepresented in these drawings? How did that get through peer review that they claim they have? So you're not going to see any credible scholar line up in any publication. You're not going to see this discussed at SBL because they have a policy that they don't talk about unprovenance things. Remember when the Museum of the Bible tried to backdoor those forged Dead Sea Scrolls by doing it in a book review session? Uh-uh, no more of this. SBL's not going to do it. ASOR's not going to do it. So you're not going to see credible scholars line up to refute this. This has always been, from the outset, a media campaign. It's a PR campaign. It's a fundraising campaign. It's a recruiting campaign. It's why Scott Stripling went on an interview over the weekend and said, we have 220 volunteers at Shiloh. We had to cut off the invitations. You know, we had to cut this off because we just have too many people. That's what this is about. It's about raising money. It's about recruiting students to his seminary, his little fundamentalist seminary there in Katy, Texas. It's about recruiting people to come dig with him. This is about fundamentalist evangelism. This is not about archaeology. It is not about science. I don't know why Heritage Science published this thing, but you can see with your own eyes using their own pictures what Gershon Galil drew and what the people that they published scan. You just look at this. You just put it on top of each other. I don't know where that mem on the right-hand side is coming from, or the Tav below it, what he's claiming. I don't know what's going, if I get my, I don't know what's going on in here. Look at all these letters that he's claiming are in here. This is sheer and utter nonsense. And that's what we mean by there's nothing there. Not only are they having to make all this stuff up, but they can't even represent their own imagination properly. This is just a simple superimposing of his own drawing over their own scans. And not only does it not line up, but he's drawing things that simply aren't there. And that's what you need to see. If you have been duped by this, if you saw this and you're like, oh, I want to believe, I'm sorry. I want to believe things like this too. And that's what a lot of people don't understand. When you're an archaeologist and you are a biblical archaeologist and you dig in the Holy Land and this is your whole career, my whole career is biblical studies and biblical archaeology. I want this stuff to be true as well. But you have to stick to solid methodology. You have to stick to the scientific process. And that's not this. This is bad science. And this is why all of the credible scholars, all the philologists, all the biblical studies people, all of the archaeologists, and all of the people who are trained in the digital humanities are rejecting this outright. They can't even get the diagrams in their own publications, things that they produced, they can't even get those to match up because they're making this up. And I'm sorry, but that's what's happening. I'm Dr. Bob Cargill wishing you everything the best.